Yes, brother.
Brother Pista, I have a question for you. For Muslims, there are 4 to 5 major criteria which he has to fulfill to enter into Jannah. But as given to understand, even from your talks and even from the neighbors, I have heard that for being a Christian, since the Christians are sinless in the sense they'll be wiped out, their sins will be wiped out because of the sins which are inherited, which are taken or by Jesus. So that means that if a person today, tonight, if he accepts that Christ has died on the cross for the sins of the mankind, does it mean that his sins, past and future, are wiped out and he will enter into the gates of heaven?
It is written in the Bible, if you believe in Christ, of course, you believe in Christ means what he did and what he taught, and you confess him, you say it, confess me, use your tongue, say it, and you receive him genuinely in your heart, then your sins are forgiven, and your my interpretation, it means this, your destination is changed. You're not in heaven at that moment.
A small question, relating to the same.
Yeah.
Now, that means if I read the Bible, I believe in each and every word of the Bible. I believe in the death of the Christ, the crucifixion, the so-called crucifixion. Then tomorrow I become a rapist or I become a terrorist and I go and killing everyone. Still I'll be entering Jannah.
You see, if you have genuinely believed in Christ today, you will not be a rapist tomorrow.
Why not? It is always possible.
Life will be so changed.
See, the thing is,
that means you are lying, you did not receive Jesus.
The thing is, there is only one single statement which shows that you have to believe in Christ, that he died for the cross, that he died on the cross and died for the sins of the mankind. That is the only criteria which I know. Even in your talk, you have said the same thing.
If you believe in Jesus, your faith is interpreted acts of faith, according to the book of James, Yaqub. If your faith is not counterfeit, not pretending, your faith will produce things in your life. But if your faith is a counterfeit, just to show, then your faith will not produce acts of faith. So suppose I'm a criminal today. I believe in Jesus, I repent, ask forgiveness of sins. All these things comes in believing in Jesus. Repentance means I have changed, I turn my way, I'm no more wanting to walk the way of sin. Then God will help me and I will succeed, not following that old way of living. My life is changed. Now I may commit mistakes. That doesn't mean I have abandoned the faith. A small baby, he loves his daddy. Still occasionally he disobeys daddy. There is a level of disobedience. Okay? There's a level of disobedience and there is a level of rejection and rebellion. So if I summarize it, if I believe in Jesus today, I repent, ask God forgiveness. God will break my sins if I have genuinely, not just pretending. He knows the secret. I'm saying it in words or not. And then that will produce things in my life. I was in Kuwait. There were many people who are playing in words in Islam. And one person, he confessed that he is Muslim. And he said, La 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 Muhammad Rasulullah. So because he wanted to take the custody of the children from his wife. So somebody taught him the trick. If you say that, then the Sharia will say the children belongs to you because your wife is Christian, so therefore they'll be in your favor. He did so. Then they told the mullah, who was a judge, he's just saying la ilaha illallah, he doesn't mean it. He said no, only God knows the intentions. He said it, we heard it, it's a proof he's a Muslim. Only God knows the intention. That was, he was just playing games and words. You know, really, he wanted to take custody of the children. Now, in the Christian faith, God knows whether you are genuine or not. If you really believed in Jesus, God will break sin over your life. He's done it. Their drug addicts are broken. Even medical couldn't help them, but they succeeded. There is an organization called Teen Challenge. They got such a big percentage of success. Even the best rehabilitation for drug addicts, they never succeeded. They only get 2%, 3%, and the boys go back, and the boys go back, and the boys go back. These people successfully, people for years, they broke with drugs because they're basing on helping the children on the basis of faith in Christ. Christ is a practical solution, not just a religion, a nice fancy drawing, and some lovely book with a little bit of colors and all that. Christ is practical for a daily living.
Yes, may we have the next question from the ladies, Dr. Zakir? Any question for Pastor Rockney from the ladies.
If we were accountable to God for our sins, then why should Jesus be crucified for us?
See,
why?
Why will God punish? Question is for Pastor Rockney.
Yes.
Yes.
Why will God punish Jesus for our sins?
If we are accountable to our sins, why should Christ die for us?
Right.
And the second part, please repeat the second part.
Why will God punish Jesus for our sins?
No. See, the law exposes sin. That is the law of Moses before Jesus. He tells you the standards of God, expectation for man. Basically, he tells me how sinful I am. Okay? So, really, sin has no remedy. As far as human is concerned, there's no remedy. And the law of Moses is a confirmation, sin has no remedy. Whatever you try, you'll fall again. Now, Jesus came to break that chain. Okay? Now, I told you at my talk earlier, if some friend of mine died for my sin, his death has no value in the eyes of God, because he is only accounted for himself. But Christ is very unique. Christ is a man who is not worthy of death. He is God, took flesh on himself, kept his power as God aside, okay, and walked as man. Now, as far as sin and judgment on him, he is not worthy of death. Therefore, he is a blameless lamb. No one on this earth is a blameless lamb in that sense. So therefore, his death was very precious, and the value was fit that only this kind of person dying, and there's only one such a person in history, that only then he has that unique office that he can take away my sin. No other person can do that. So that is the reason, because his being not as committed sin makes him that blameless, acceptable lamb before God. That is the reason why his position is very unique. That's the reason. I hope I made it a little... Huh? Okay? His position as sinless person who is not worthy of death, that makes him the perfect lamb acceptable to God to receive sin of people.
So does that mean that we are not accountable for our sins if we just believe in him?
You see, I just mentioned to the gentleman, believe is translated into real acts of faith. There are people who believe just for some various benefits. Maybe you'll get some good salary from some foreign organization. There are many people who do that, but God knows the secrets, okay? But I'm saying, if you believe, your life will show. Your life will show, okay? Judas the Iscariot believed, but really it was not really faith. Afterwards we saw, for the sake of 30 pieces of coins, he betrayed his master. Really, from beginning he didn't believe. That was a counterfeit belief. Conditional belief. Belief only if things goes well. Okay? So the book of James says, if you believe, your life will show. Okay? It's not belief. I don't mean just say words, you know. I mean say words, you mean it. Okay? I mean, in a sincere heart, asking God, acknowledging my helplessness because of my sin, and asking God to forgive me in the name of his son Jesus, that's the only way to receive forgiveness of sin. Whatever you do, there's no other way.
Sorry, but if you're saying that God took the flesh and bone.
I think you have put your question forward. The pastor has explained. We cannot have another question.
The first question was
your question for the answer. I mean, can I ask, please?
You can try your...
You'd like to give a short one-line comment.
Yes. Like, I mean, it's a counter question. As said by Pastor, that a true believer in Jesus Christ will never become a rapist tomorrow. But if you see the Christians or on a whole, you see that every Christian do sin. So that means you're trying to say that no Christian is a true believer of Jesus Christ.
You are talking about non-believer Christians. There are many people who have the labels of being Christians. There are many people having the labels of being Christians, and they're doing atrocities, and they're, even the British when they were in India, in my personal opinion, if it hurts you, I don't mind, I'm sorry, but they misrepresented Christ in India. They were Christian name. Like if my name is Sharma, I'll be called Tony and Johnny. if I become a Christian. Really, the heart is not changed, only external. These are not representative of the faith of Jesus. There is believers Christians and there is traditional Christians. They're not the same. These traditional, they are just mix up of religions, just having the label of Christianity. That way, you're looking at the people who are traditional. They're two different things. We Christians, we don't worship idols. We don't put photos and bow to it. I asked my pastor. We don't know. I used to do that in the past. I refused. When I started reading the Bible and the Torah, and I stopped doing that. I never knew. I used to worship idols. I used to pray to the dead spirits. And God has forbidden such things. I never knew. I was also called Christians. I used to pray to persons other than the Almighty God. A mediator, and all these things. Only God can forgive sins. And you are mixing between a person having a label Christians and a person who is a believer Christians. I'm talking about the Bible Christians, about those who believe in the Bible. Those are dynamic Christians. Those type of Christian I'm talking about. Okay, so you maybe have seen people who don't believe in the Bible. They just call Christians. They may be having some Western name or something.
Now we would just allow another three more questions before we wind up. Those who are standing, I would request no further people to come up and queue up because you would not get a chance. We have one brother here. We'll allow one more brother. And I think that we have been waiting for a long time. Okay. We'll allow you the third question before we close the session. The management has given us 10 minutes.
Brother Zaki, you are telling that in the Bible somewhere it is written that when Jesus came back, the disciples were terrified and they were afraid. Why they are afraid when he is not dead?
That was the question. That when Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, goes to the upper room where the disciples had gathered there, why were they afraid when he was not dead? That is the question which I had asked during the talk. Why were they afraid? And the answer is given, because they thought he was the spirit. They thought he was a spirit.
But he is not dead, you said.
That's what I'm telling you. So they did not know that.
But he is dead. Okay, come tomorrow. You die and you come over here, everybody will get scared and run away from here.
I agree with you. Suppose if I read in the newspaper that this person fell from the 10th floor.
Yeah.
And you think he's dead. But tomorrow if he comes, I'm going to get scared. But then he tells me, when I fell down, there was a lorry of hay going. I didn't die. So it's from hearsay I had heard. He had fallen and he died. But when he comes, I, being a doctor, examine him. I check his hand. He's alive. So initially, I'll be afraid. But when I check up with him, I'm not afraid. Similarly, here, initially.
But the disciples, he's dead.
Let me complete the answer. Then you can speak. No problem, brother. I'll give you time. You can come again. You can come to IRF. Let me complete the answer. They thought, the Bible says, Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, verse 37. They were affrighted and terrified and supposed him to be a spirit. Supposed. Who says that? Not Dr. Zakir Naik. Who says that? Luke. They thought him to be a spirit. But then he says, handle me and see. For a spirit has no flesh and bones. Then they were overjoyed. First they were afraid because they thought he was a spirit. When he proved to them he was no spirit, they were overjoyed. Who says that? Gospel of Luke.
The gospel says that Jesus was dead. And he was buried. And then he comes. You said that, brother. You said that. I don't know.
Brother, you have asked your question. He has given his answer. Excuse me. You have asked your question. The speaker has given his response. I think God has given most of the people here a good heart, a good mind. And they can decide for themselves. We are not going to comment on it. What the decision of the audience is, let them decide for themselves. That is the basic premise we had of this friendly discussion, so that we come to a better understanding of each other's viewpoints and not fight over it. Just understand each other's viewpoint in its proper perspective. We have two experts who know their job. Let them give the answers. If you know it better, tomorrow you hire a big hall and maybe invite someone else and people will come and hear you. They are happy hearing you now. Yes, brother. You can carry on with the answer.
So all the statements were from hearsay. They thought him to be a spirit because they had heard that he had died. Heard from hearsay. They weren't eyewitnesses. Who says that? Gospel of Mark, chapter 14, verse 50. All of them fled at the most critical juncture of the life of JFK, peace be upon him. They all forsook and left him. Who says that? The gospel says that. They fled. It was from hearsay. And he proved to them by showing his hand that he was not a spirit. And pastor said, and he gave the reason for salvation, the two questions posed earlier. And the pastor said that you have to believe in Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. He has died for your sins. And then after that, you should not sin. I don't get it. That if someone has paid for my sin, then what is the problem in me doing sin? If someone tells me, go to a restaurant, Delhi Darbar, I've paid for your bills, eat as much as you want. And then say, don't have chicken. I say, why? You have paid for my bill. Why not have chicken? Don't have mutton. I say, why? That you told me a lie. When you told me that you paid for everything, whatever you have, eat as much as you want for your full life. Now why are you telling me don't have chicken? Don't have mutton? That you told me a lie. So if Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, paid for our sins, then what's the problem in us ripping? What's the problem in us robbing? So this logic, if you understand, it doesn't go into the logical mind of a person. Hope that answers the question.
Yes, brother. That's the second last question for Pastor Rukni.
My question to Mr. Rukni. As you know, that every country have his criminal law. And anyone who is doing wrong thing is going to be punished according to the criminal law of the country. And because even though, if you take up newspaper, you will see thousands of murders and rapes and a lot of things are going on in the world. Suppose, as you said earlier in your speech, in the beginning, that Jesus was already crucified. He was not crucified for his sins, but he was crucified for the sins of human being, for the sins of Christians. If we believe that Jesus was crucified for all Christians, then what is going to be the situation of the world?
Yeah, shall I complete?
Yeah.
It is written that Jesus died for the sins of the whole world, that anyone who believes in him will have the gift of salvation. Potentially, it is for you and for everybody.
Then who is going to handle the situation after that? If everybody starts believing that,
yes.
And I can kill you right now here, and I can tell tomorrow into the court that Mr. Jesus is crucified for my sins, and you cannot testify me, then can you write on the paper that this guy should not be testified, as Mr. Jesus is already crucified for him?
I have answered this question earlier in the book of James, in Hindi, in Yaqub says, if you really believed, you will not kill me.
You write it and give that if Mr. Iftikhar is killing today here, and he should not be testified tomorrow in the court of the law of the Indian Constitution.
Yes.
Can you give me in writing now?
Just a minute.
I will believe tomorrow that Jesus was crucified. I will believe tomorrow. And yes. I will be a perfect Christian.
See, there are two things in sin. As I said, there is sin and there is damage of sin. Okay? There is sin itself.
A simple thing I can tell you.
No,
see, you are a believer. You are
brother.
A believer, a perfect believer is a Christian. Huh? Today morning, I told my daughter, I want to know each and every table from 1 to 20. You read it and I will listen in the evening. Just to keep me happy, she learned everything she kept in mind and repeated in the evening. Mr. Zakir is not a Christian. He is a Muslim. But he can quote each and every verse from your Bible, any Bible. And you are a believer. You say, I am a believer. I am this and that. I love Christ. But you cannot quote a single line from the Bible.
Brother, you have to put...
Shall I answer?
I would request you to maintain patience. You have to put forward your question rather than passing comments on what the speaker knows or doesn't know. That is his right, what he knows or doesn't know.
Now,
you have to just put forward your question and await an answer.
I mentioned there is sin, and there is a result of sin. Okay? Now, for example, a poor man who just survived by little food, I'm a thief, I rob his food and he dies, he got no food to eat. Okay? Sometime later, some faithful God servant come and tell me, you are a thief and you should not do that. Then I realize I have done a horrible thing which cannot be repaired. There's a man died because of my robbing. But he reforms me. I ask Jesus to forgive me my sins. And then my destiny is changed. My destiny is changed. Yeah, that is true. That's a fact. It's a promise in the Bible. It is God's word. But can I repair the damage? I have killed a man. I denied him his food. Answer is no. Then the police will catch me, and according to the law of the country, I may have to be hung because of that. Yes, I have to bear the consequences of the harm I did. But my soul is saved because my destiny is changed. God has wiped my sin from his presence, but there is a damage I caused, which is so serious, and there is a price for it in this earth. So many sins, they're so serious, I cannot repair it even after becoming a Christian. There is another situation. I do a minor thing. Let's say I cheat Saji. And then tomorrow God convicts me. I ask him forgiveness. God, I'm sorry for my sin. I have cheated Saji. Saji, take your pen back. I have cheated you that day. That's a minor sin where I can restitute. It is possible to restitute. But the case where a man died because of my being a horrible person earlier cannot be restituted, and there is a law in the country, and I have to bear the consequences of that. So there is the sin and there is the damage. Not all damage can be repaired. For example, if I am alcoholic, very heavy drinker, all my youth was spent in drinking. At the old age, some faithful servant of God comes and tell me, ask God forgiveness. I ask God forgiveness in the name of Jesus. I receive a free gift of salvation, free of charge. I haven't worked for it. God changed my destiny. But what happened? During all my youth, I have been drinking beer. And my liver developed fibroid. And then slowly, slowly, I waste and die because of that. The damage of sin all my life has damaged my life, but thank God my soul is saved. See, this is the damage of sin I have done all these years, but my soul is saved because I ask forgiveness. It's a free gift. It's a free gift. God, take the justice that I deserve out of me and put it on Jesus. That is the strange exchange, that Jesus takes it from you and put it on himself. Nobody is willing to can do that. I hope I answered it.
I'm not certified.
Yes.
Yes, brother. This would be the last question for the evening. We would request the audience to be seated after the answer for another 1 or 2 minutes. Bear with us for a few minutes more. Yes, brother.
My name is Sunny Matthew. I'm a manpower consultant. Name of my company is Sigma Manpower and Marketing Private Limited. Well, the question to Dr. Sagir Nayak is, or the debate subject what we have today is, was Christ really crucified? Asking a counter question is not the answer for the question. It's a simple logical theory. The subject of today is not whether Jesus has resurrected or not. That subject, when you are dealing it on the problem, the evidence for resurrection, which we can find out only from the Bible. And it is a belief of the Christians. And as you mentioned, you are not believing in Christ, Bible is a word of God, and then you are taking the quotation from Bible and proving that resurrection is not taking place, and then saying that is why the crucifixion is not taking place, is a good logic. But when we approaching the subject, I personally believe it is not right. Another point. Yeah, the same question, it's a continuation, but one more point on that. Now, it is a historical fact. The crucifixion or death of Christ is a historical fact where the historians has written it on that. A Jewish historian called Josephus has written about the crucifixion of Christ. And it was not a secret. In a rally, people has been tortured him and crucified it on that. Then what happened to Christ if Christ has not died? Whether he has hidden somewhere else, his body has taken down from the cross and it has been laid down. There were people witnessing it on that. But how can you deny it on this? And the last continuation, because I am the last person to question.
Brother,
it.
I'll just answer you. You can ask a new question.
No, this is
already asked three,
brother,
four questions.
You have already asked, I think,
three questions.
Three
you can
questions.
Ask, no problem.
You
I'll have a chairperson to ask
no,
you one more.
You will no,
give
brother,
one chance? Yes,
I'll
give
brother,
one.
You'll give? Brother,
yeah, last
will,
chance.
We will.
I'll just answer this question.
We will just let him answer the three questions. In fact, the management has put a limitation.
Yeah.
Let him answer the three questions. If time permits and the management permits, we might.
One comment. Brother, question. Not answer, a comment.
Brother, this is the question and answer time.
Yeah.
You are allowed to ask only a question, not pass a comment. You can come to the IRF, call him to your place, whatever you'll agree to, do that after the program is over. I can't allow it now. Please.
Yeah, come on.
Please, I cannot allow you now. Okay. May we have the answers to the questions already posed?
The brother posed 4 questions. He said the topic was Christ really crucified? And I posed the question, was he resurrected? And then he said, because he resurrected, he was not resurrected, therefore he's not crucified. You're going it the opposite way. What I was trying to do is kill 2 birds with 1 stone. I do not have another debate whether Christ was resurrected or not. 2 birds with 1 stone. If he did not die, he was not crucified. If he did not die, he was not resurrected. 2 birds with 1 stone. So even if you remove the word resurrection, yet the arguments remain the same. And you can have the video cassette later on when it's released. First I said, if a person doesn't die, he's not crucified. And then I went to say that for resurrection also death is required. So I'm killing 2 birds with 1 stone trying to prove that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, did not die. If he did not die, he was not crucified. If he did not die, how can he be resurrected? I am killing 2 birds with 1 stone. But I am sticking to the topic. I am not going away from the topic. Because both these things are important. According to Paul, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 14, that, and if Christ did not die and rise, our preaching is vain and your faith is vain. So I am killing 2 birds with 1 stone. You can refer to the cassette. You ask the next question that historians have said, Jewish historian, that he has been crucified. Do you know, brother, how much of material has been written on Christ has been really crucified? Double the material written that he was not crucified. Historical records. You can come to IRF. I can quote Venturi, a German philosopher. He said, St. Paulus, I can give you how many names you can give, I'll give you double the quantity names of historians, not Muslims, Christians, non-Muslims. I give the names. The fourth question. If Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, did not die, what happened to him? Was he put below the earth, etc.? I feel you didn't hear my talk and my rebuttal and my question and session. I made it very clear in Surah Nisa, chapter 4, verse 157. Wama kataluhu wama salabuhu. They didn't kill him, neither did they crucify him. It was only made to appear so. Next verse, Surah Nisa, chapter 4, verse 158, it says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised him up alive. I've said that he was raised up alive unto himself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, unto himself. It is even mentioned Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 55, that he was raised up alive. And he'll be coming again in the second coming. So all your 4 questions have been answered. And the pastor said, what I have got from his answer which he gave earlier. Every time I meet a Christian, I get a new answer. He said that certain damages cannot be repaired. He said that. It is on video. That means, for certain sins, Jesus Christ cannot pay. What I get to understand, every time I meet a new Christian, I get a new ideology of Christianity. That for small sins, Christ has paid, peace be upon him. For big sins, he has not paid. That's what I understand. Yes, brother, you had some comment.
Brother, you can just ask your question instead of a comment. Well, because in his 5 minutes, there are yet 2-3 minutes left. I will allow him to answer only in the 3 minutes, not the 5 minutes.
Okay.
Yes, brother. Quickly your question, quickly the answer, within 3 minutes.
Okay. Now the entire argument which you have given based on the biblical quotings, and when actually the subject was the Christ has really crucified, what you have there to talk from the Quran? Quran, when you are saying, if you are saying a statement and if you are repeating a statement, that's not an argument. I say there is a God and I say 20 times there is a God, that's not an argument. Argument requires subsequent support. So what support you can give from Quran for Christ has not crucified other than that of the statement? I expect a reply, not to get the clap from the audience, but for a non-Muslim can understand, and getting of a clap is simple, but making others understanding is difficult. So not to get a clap, but to me understand on that.
The brother asked a very good question, that if you make a statement, it doesn't become a fact. It should be from authentic source. And I do agree. If I quote from the Quran, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was not crucified, you need not agree. Why? Because according to you, the Quran is not authentic. I've got no problem. But for the Muslims, it's authentic. They say it's the word of God. For them, it is sufficient proof. If I say,
anything from the Bible, what happened to Christ, it may not be proof for the Muslims, but for the Christians it will be. Do you agree the Bible to be the word of God or not? You agree? Good, he agrees. So a proof from the Bible, Jesus Christ was not crucified. So why do you require historical proof? Do you think historical proof is superior to God's word? Don't clap, please. He doesn't want you to clap. He wants to understand.
It's a matter of faith. It's a matter of the proof should be, it's a matter of faith. That's why it was required.
That's right. I'm saying, as long as you are convinced, I'm not here to convince the non-Christians. To convince the non-Christian, I can give historical proof. We can have a new debate. If a non-Christian comes and tells me that he
quoted the Bible from here and there, it's not a proof for me.
Who quoted?
The quotation which you have quoted is right, but it has picked up from a wrong place which has mentioned on a wrong incident.
Brother has that allegation. I have quoted rightly, but out of context. You give the context. No problem. It's a friendly discussion for understanding. Come to IRF. You give the context and we'll discuss it. You're most welcome.
I'll come and meet you then.
Jazakallah khair. We thank God Almighty for making this evening of understanding each other's viewpoints between two major faiths of this world possible for all of us present here. We would like to thank the India Gospel Mission and the Islamic Research Foundation for getting together to organize this program. I would like to personally thank Pastor Rokhni, Pastor Saji, Dr. Zakir, and all of us present here today. Jazakumullah khairan.
Okay.
May God reward all of you.
The law.